is the guy that's tasked with trying to do something that nobody else has ever been able to do. Let's try to sort youth football out in this area, and that's Phil Sackey. The joys athletic has never had a decent youth football system. Never. But Phil has actually managed to start getting something decent going. So, Phil Sackey, come up here. The next person up is the person that got, did you get, was it haircut of the year in 2006? The haircut, yeah. Oh, right, okay. So, the next person is a guy that's had three spells at Grays, haircut of the year. He actually was top scorer with 4 goals in 2009-2010. Yeah? So, Jamie Slabber, come on down! And finally, what can you say about this man? He's the gaffer. He got player of the decade in 2010, but wasn't able to collect it because we were supposed to go and bust that day. Hall of Famer, Jamie Stuart. Let's have a bit of fun, guys. You put your hand up, you can ask a question. Players, it's time to get the gaffer. Right, who wants to ask a question first? Come on, put your hand up. Oh, someone's on the run. Come on, anyone. Guys, what? Look, at the moment, tomorrow, you've got, what is it, Mumford Town? Here we go.
Slabber, I just got a question for you. Can you hear me now? Alright, sounds good. I just got a question for you, I just wanted to know what it was like coming out, playing for the top of the first team. And what experience, I want to be a professional footballer and you've had that experience, so I'd like to know what it's like first hand.
Hello. Good question that is, Jack. Very good question. No, it was good. Yeah, it was just a dream come true, I suppose. Like, the boys. But yeah, if you stop giving the ball away, you might be a part. What he's saying is that when you've got 10 minutes on the quarterback and no one near you, give it to someone last night.
Right, put your hand up. Oh, Phil Boston.
This is one for Jamie.
Which one?
Jamie Slabber. In the trophy semi final against Exeter, boys like Scordy equaliser, and he got us through to the final.
What was it like?
Living
the dream, huh? Yeah, that was good. Yeah, we had a good team back then as well, so yeah, it was quite quite easy to score. We had an attacking team and ended up a good day in the end, didn't it? Like, in the final. Guys, it was a very good day, so it was good. Can't really remember that far back now. Long time.
It's all about heading the ball. You head the ball quite a bit, you know, American football and all that stuff.
Oh, yeah,
that's
okay.
Yeah, I can't hit that as well because I used to. Anybody else? Are we going to the street?
Well, first of all, it's nice to have a mic that works. Question to the master, who's the best player you played with? That's it, like, you said about the master, you just handed him the mic.
I always just say, mate, me too.
In your pro career, who's the best player you played with?
Well, that's a tough question. A lot of Mariners players, some great players, against some great players, but I think when I was with the England under-21s, and when I was playing for them, I obviously played with David Beckham. We have a little ongoing joke at football with the boys. Sometimes when I drop a few names, they don't even forget about that. Especially my young centre-half over there, Jack Fowler. I try to guide him, nurture him into being good and better, you know, so he's learning very well. No, but David Beckham, Paul Scholes, was a great player, did play with Charlton. Ability wise on the training ground, he did some fantastic things. There's loads of players. Played against Janola when he was at Tottenham, I was playing left back, and I'm proud to say that I might have been out again. I played against Fowler, Sheeran, Les Ferdinand, I remember you might be in the field, Tony Daly, the right winger at Aston Villa. He was absolutely rapid, marked him out again. It's been really good players, but I'm not that again. But it's some players I look up to, some old pros, you know, the guys being looked after well, I've learned a lot from them. Obviously, ability-wise, maybe not as much ability, but what they had was fantastic. They had that winning mentality, that work rate, and that goes a long, long way.
Anybody else? Oh. Here we go.
When Charlton picked you up?
What age were we? I was 14. I got picked up by a district team. I was playing for Kent at Bexley in Kent. I moved from London with my mum, living in Sika. I was playing a district game. I had Palace, I had Charlton, Millwall, quite a few other clubs there. I asked them to go down. I went to Palace, they tried to bump my mum with a few grand to make me sign a contract there. But I ended up going to Charlton, I felt comfortable there. It's the area, it's close to my mum, who I just moved to. So I was 14, I was in their training, and they noticed my ability. At 15, started training the first team. Charlton actually took me out of school at 15 and started giving me the education there. Obviously, a lot of years later, what went on in my past life. Guidances, people you mix with, things like that. Went off route a bit, but Charlton was the club that nurtured me and was close to my heart then.
Okay, Mr. Packer, got a question.
The question's for Phil. Who's the best player you coached and who's the worst player coaching at the moment? Present company accepted the latest question to call, so I don't know the answers.
The worst player we coach at the moment, or the worst player I've coached?
Sorry. I've been watching the Hobbit channel all afternoon. Sorry. It was like one of those disaster movies. Okay, Phil. Disaster. Come on.
Best player I've coached. He's currently playing with Southend Manor. reserves, 20-year-old, fantastic ability, small, nobody really recognises him. But he's one which I'll try and do and bring in. He's a man like the ruler. Yeah, and you want to put the worst player who... Tony, worst player what? We coach at the moment. Or the worst trainer. Well, it could be, it's a toss up of three of them. Yeah, it could be a toss up of three of them. We've got one or three players who've had an injury, a lot of injury. So it becomes the worst trainer, and we've probably got three in that. So, yeah, I'll keep the names anonymous for now.
Okay, who's next? Who's next? Oh!
This is for the gaffer. Right, Gaff. I'll just get it. Yeah, alright, mate. What I find out, in terms of, we looked at the costs, what we're bringing in, incomings, outgoings. After we've seen it, we've made it clear, you know, what are we going for in your eyes this season? Is it playoffs? Is it to win it? Is it just to be comfortable in this league?
That's a good question, Stan. I think it's a lot underlying people on the back. Good questions, Dan. It's a hard one to answer. I'll put it on the spot, I'll answer it as short as I can. When I, last season, got relegated, I was hurting bad. It really, really hurt me. I don't want to go into what this club means at the moment with that question, but it means a lot to me, and being successful here means a lot to me. At the start of the season, I was looking for a straight promotion. I'll be honest, I'm hungry, I'm passionate, I'm fortunate to know a lot of people in the game, hence why a lot of yous are here now. A lot of yous players have offers from higher clubs, and you've come with me, and I respect that, and yous obviously comes for you, you respect me. I wanted to win promotion straight away. Start of the season, pre-season, as it's gone on, a few things happened, like we spoke about earlier. I had players lined up, things happened. I had core team lined up, not going into detail with players, but we had a midfielder, a lot of you know about Ashton, things like that. Things happen in football. Sometimes you lose players and you can't compete. But we regrouped, we kept building, we kept trying to do the right things, build the squad, and you was a massive part of the team getting you in from a higher level. So that's why you're captain, Stan, because of your mentality. You're an old red, you know what I'm about, and I know what you're about, that's why you're a captain. But I still believe, and I honestly do mean this from the bottom of my heart, I'm going for the players. People say we played a couple more games or three more games than other people. I don't care about that. I've been at clubs, Rushden Diamonds, for example, with Justin Edinburgh, which a lot of you will know. We was down in the bottom. We made a big surge late on, everyone ripped us off, we played too many games, but we did it. We stuck together, we kept doing the right things, and listen, in football, you could lose one, draw one, win one, but all of a sudden, you have a good little run, you put a few runs together, build them points up, and anything can happen. Okay, if I'm talking about what Steve and Glenn spoke about earlier, finances, and being realistic, if I was being realistic, and we was working on that budget, and I didn't have the contacts and the respect of some of you that I know I've got, hence why you're here, we wouldn't be where we are now. We had missed a couple of opportunities. I spoke to a lot of the boys about, okay, a few weeks ago, we're 2 points off the playoffs, we're nearly there, don't let yourselves down, don't miss it. We missed that boat, and it came round again, we missed it again, and it happened again on New Year's Day, and I was hurting like you always have been. But Football's funny, trust me, football, it can be good, it can be horrible, but it can be full of surprises. Okay, we're sitting where we are, everyone's put us off, but I know what squad I've got, and this is what I say to the boys every session, every game. Play it like it's your last game. Give it your all, work hard, wear the shirt with pride. And we're doing that at the moment. And listen, a bit more up the green, keep working as hard, we're doing it, I believe we can make them players.
Okay. Well, who's next? Ben.
It's Phil, please. I'm the dad of a 6-year-old football mayor kid, who's one sat next to me in the same boat. What's your vision for the future of youth football in Brazil? How would you see this?
Is that from an ambitious parent or a supportive parent? Which one is it? I think where the board and Steve and the rest of the club are, I think probably locally, Grays will be the go-to place to build youngsters rather than you probably find over the last 15 years the go-to place was probably Thurrock. They have a better use set up than Grays. I think you'll find over the next 2-3 years going forward, it'll be Grays, purely and simply because people have seen the youngsters going through at 15, 16 into the first team and training in around the first team. So the linkage is really there, the pathway is there. So we're already getting known locally, and we're getting recognition from the field as well. Such that it's going to be no surprise that when you've got the champions at Billericay who are paying big sums for big name players to come in, you'll find that the youth and the parents of the youth there will feel that there's no pathway for them. Such that they'll turn away from that and come back to here, if that makes sense. So I think that the youth section here and the youth setup will be thriving. I think historically we had 22 teams playing in Grays at one stage. Back in the Woodward days, I think you'll exceed that over the next 5 years. Providing we get
this is something that's always close to my heart as well. For we've never done it properly in this club, never. And I know from feedback from people that are involved with the youth setup at the moment, you're doing it the right way, but. Is it going to be a way that the local boys are going to get it, or is it like the other clubs, they take it from anywhere? Because at the moment, Thurrock are successful because they'll go into London, they'll take boys from 50 miles away. Are we going to take boys from locally? You've got the Callum Thompson, you've got the Kai Browns, who are local boys, who succeeded. You know, you've got Robinson in the youth setup as well, a local boy. Are these guys going to be the ones, you know, are we going to go through a 10-mile radius around like the Graves area? Because there's enough boys, I can name, you know, 5 or 6 boys who are capable of coming into your youth setup at the moment and playing for the first team tomorrow.
Well, again, this is why, is it? I think Steve was saying earlier, you know, it's community-based clubs, therefore we're an open door. We're not going to stop you if you come in and say, excuse me, fellow engineer, what's your postcode number? That's not how it works. If the product is good and people want to come in, the door's open. If the product is bad and people have come in and they don't want to stay, then you go. It's not a problem. So whether you come from E14 or RM16 and 17, the door's open. So as a youth setup, and if you've got supporting parents and they can get you from E14, SG1, Stephen, whatever,
if
you want to come,
great,
our door's open.
Yeah, because if you mean, but to me, you know, we missed a boat back in the 90s, I don't know if you know, but Palmer's College, which is a great college, they won the English Schools Cup. Not one player played for Grays. They're all local players. They all come from Thurrock. Not one player. Ailey had them, Tilbury had them, East Thurrock had them. They all had them, but great athletic. Is that not the way that we want to look? Do we not think that we can enhance our thing from a perspective of local football? Because I think there's enough boys around here that locally that can fill the youth teams. And good enough as well.
Yeah, definitely. As I said, there's no barriers to anyone who wants to go in. In the past, I've taken teams to county cup finals, and we don't run trials. Yeah, so if his mate for me wants to bring him along and says, can he join in? Absolutely no problem. So if you live in Thurrock, then I think that Grays will be the go-to club. Historically, people would go to Thurrock, East Thurrock. We find now that boys are going to Concord because of their playing in Conference South. So, tagging on from what Bill was saying, as you drop down the levels, say if you were to drop to Essex Senior, it may well be that people will be saying, I want my son to go to a Ryman North, Ryman South, Ryman Prem, Conference, etc., etc. Then that situation may change. You know? So at the moment, East Thurrock, they're probably getting the bigger letter as well as Concord. But because they're set up here is great, people can see the pathway. If it continues, say with the likes of Kai and Callum and the other boys that are coming through, the parents will, well, my boys don't want to get looking at East Thurrock, he's not going to get looking at Concord, so therefore Grays will be the go-to club. And whether they come from Grays per se, or a 10-mile, 15-mile radius, it's not going to, I think last year we had three boys playing for County, local Grays lads that were playing for Grays. So if that will only spread, as the youth, if you like, network is cast at 10, etc., they will permeate into our squad and they'll stay there. They'll stay in our setup and off they go elsewhere.
Okay. Okay, have a look. It's more of a statement than actually than a question. I have a manager of the under 13s, and what he was asking Phil, I've got a squad of 15 boys, 8 of them go to a Thurrock school, and the other 7 go to a school in Romford area. So all very local. And yet you're right, you've got other clubs. Before I come over and spoke to Steve and we took the 13s on this year, I went over to Billy Vicky and I listened to all the spiel at the start and when all the boys went for their trial and he was telling everybody our plan is in 2 or 3 years time we're going to be here, we're going to be there, we're going to buy our way there. And I actually made a statement then, that wasn't what I wanted to hear. I've got a 12-year-old boy. I used to run Brentwood when he played Phil's side last year, and the Fireland boys got 16, 17 wearing games in the first team. That's what I want to be. I want to be a much older 13-year-old who's going to have a chance to play. Yeah, he's not going to make a living playing football, but he could earn a bit of money, and that's what I want to be. That he's got a chance of making it in that first team. I don't want to say, oh, Billy, he'll be at 17. Then where are you going to go? Because you ain't going to be going playing in the first team. Because he spent more money. So I actually think, personally, for me, that's why we come to Thurrock team, you know, Grays. Because they were making all the right noises for me. And I said to my parents, you've got 6, 7 boys at 16, 17, 18 playing for a first team. You know, your boys are only 4 or 5 years away, possibly, from that, if they don't get their nut down. So I think, to be fair, that Grays are now, in the youth, doing things right. And we watch Phil, we watch Phil's coaching, he coaches my boys. My 13s train with his 16s and 18s all together. And some people might think, oh, but that's good for my boys, because they don't want to hang on to the ball for too long. They're not scared, but they'll move the ball about. And that's what we want to move the ball about. And then, you know, it makes them more aware. You know, it works well for us. And I think as a youth team,
I said, I think, you know, like, all the white noise is for me, and I'm just thinking that five years' time, some of my boys, if they carry on, I'll see you out in Croatia at the first team.
I don't think that's just a question for Phil, I think that's the question for the first team manager as well.
Yeah, no, exactly. I'll make you right, that's a good point. When I come here, obviously I wasn't quite aware of the work that Phil was doing, and he's doing a fantastic job. There's some great young players there that Phil's brought over, nurtured. And it's about giving them players opportunities. I don't care how old you are, if you're good enough, you can mix it with the boys, give you a chance. You've seen that, proof in the pudding. You've got young Callum there, young Kai Brown, who's obviously he's off having a trial somewhere, I won't go too much into that, but there's opportunities there. These are boys that commit to us. You've got a young boy like Trey, who's travelling all over from Brixton. He gets trained over, a young lad, he was at Digelitz. He's had opportunities there, but these young boys, if they're good enough, they'll get a chance. Some managers won't give them a chance. I'm a great believer in age is just a number. You know, it don't matter how big, how small you are, you could be the smallest player in the park, but so what? If you can mix it and you're good enough, there's your chance. And proof in the pudding, we've got young Callum who's come in the last two games, and he's been absolutely fantastic. I spoke to Callum, I spoke to his dad before, he will get his opportunity. We've got a good strong squad, competition for places, and I'll try to be as fair as I can. But if someone's not putting their weight, and you've got a young lad who's doing well in training, he's in front of the first team, that's it, simple.
Anyone else? Okay, we've got Dave Seaman.
It's one for the two Jamies. What was your most memorable games when we was in the conference? And what was your most disappointing games?
I think my most memorable game of conference was probably when I scored a hat trick against Cambridge for Rovers. That was my most memorable, definitely. Yeah, good night, Alex.
It's been a lot, it's been a few. One of them is probably when we played Coffey's team, Burton. They did expect us down there to give them a hiding, and we gave them a total hiding. I think we kept the ball for 75 minutes of the game, just playing some sexy soccer, that's for you, Bish. And it was just great, you know, we weren't expecting nothing. There were some great memories there. I mean, listen, in football, if you achieve things and win things at a place with a team, you grow great bonds with youth, the fans, the great people. And at that time, the team we had, you know, every game we played, there was an arrogance, a confidence, a buzz about us. And that's just being in a great team of winners. And they're some of the best memories of my life, you know, and I'll never change that. But we've had some great games. One of the devastating games was me, was losing the Halifax game up there, because we should have beat them. We went up there, I think there was a couple of mistakes, not by me, obviously. There's a couple of mistakes, it was frustrating. There's a couple of goals down, so what's going on? And we come into the game, and we was the better team. We played in the replay, and we absolutely battered them at home, if you remember that game. And we was, that hurt. But no, there's been many games, some great memories, and there's something I'll take with me for the rest of my life.
Okay, anyone else?
Yeah,
okay, go.
I'm not sure if this works. Do the players like playing on that new surface as compared to grass?
Yeah, I don't think so much a problem now. Honestly, times have changed and some of the older pros, I mean, when I was at Sutton years back, I was playing on the AstroTurf there. At a point in your career, like me, Stanley, some of the older players, when it's a sudden change, you can feel the effects, stiffness, not used to it. But the more you train it, the more you get used to it, I don't think it's that much of a problem. Unless you're an older pro with old injuries, scar tissue, niggles, then it can play out, you know. And you have to monitor them. There we go. Yeah. He goes and has a rubber play session, isn't he? But no, listen, no, a lot of the boys are used to it. You know, I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's a good thing all round.
Okay.
for the future as well.
Okay, I know Ben's there, but this is a question from me to the two Jamies. What, in the first season we was in the Conference National, would you say was the turning point of us not winning the league? Because for me personally, I think it was when Lee Matthews, you know, was injured and that he couldn't come through. I thought we could never replace Lee Matthews properly, and we never did. What would you say? Because to me, that was the turning point, because Lee was your partner, just, you know, a solid, stable centre-half partnership.
Good question. For me, yeah, Lee Matthews, fantastic player, but we had a good, strong squad in depth. You know, we had players that could come in and do just as good a job. Us, the competition was phenomenal. For me, I think obviously behind the scenes, a lot of things went on from certain people. And listen, I don't want to, I'm honest, what you see is what you get from me. But at that time, there was things going on. Obviously, wages being paid in late. People not getting paid what they're meant to, this and that, and then that was a build-up stuff. A few times we had unhappy players, and when we start getting a little bad camp, it's not good. So there's a build-up before that, from a player's point of view, because I was in that squad, I see what was going on, I was there for a long time, and that don't help, you know. But obviously, yeah, a few injuries, like you said, Matthews, that was a big blow. But I still think we had enough in that squad to achieve things. But when people get sidetracked with certain distractions, you know, it's hard.
Slept. Slept.
Yeah, I mean, we had a great squad. I think definitely underachieved, really. I think we should have won that league outright. I mean, with the players we had. And who bought in as well?
Because you were part of what's recognised statistically anyway as the strongest conference team after Wigan Wanderers. So, no.
Yeah,
that says quite a bit.
Yeah, it was up there, it was fine. We should have won it. We did. I think we had a bad Christmas period, didn't we?
Yeah, there was a spell just around Christmas and New Year.
Yeah,
I think about January we went down to about.
Yeah.
I think it was sixth place at one point.
And that's when, that's when sort of, things behind the scenes was kind of at me. And I don't know, I suppose we took our half the ball bit. But no, we definitely underachieved. I know we won the trophy, but the league, we should have won it because the players we had were unbelievable.
Yeah, well, the players were, you know, like I say, I think personally, but Lee Matthews' injury, myself, was the thing that swung it because he never got a proper partner for Jamie after Lee got injured.
Yeah, there were quite a few centre-half partners after that, but when I sort of come that time, sort of Lee Matthews was sort of, I know Stimmer was sort of edging him out a bit, so I didn't really know him or how good he sort of was. So. But players we were bringing in,
there was a game that Jamie didn't play, and they played a guy called Nathan Coo Booth.
Yeah.
Next to Lee. I think Jamie might have actually been suspended at that time, but he's possibly one of the worst players ever to play for Grove. And the fact that Lee Matthews had probably a man of the match performance, that we actually won the game. He was absolutely awful.
No comment. Oh, come on, no. He was absolutely pants.
Thank you. Back to Slabs. Andy Nathan Coo both right next to Gavin Hoyt, who you played with in the last season of the conference.
I thought Gavin Hoyt was better. Just edged it.
Edged it?
Yeah, he had boots on the right foot.
I say something. Okay, Ben, you've got a question.
Yeah, I think firstly I just want to echo the comments about Nathan, we both being shit. more importantly, for Slabs, actually, when you finally hang out the boots and you look back on the career, for you, there's probably a few key areas you can look back and think, I just want to know what's going to make you particularly proud of, really. Is it that initial time you had Spurs and you learned there and the setup? Is it what you want in the game? Is it more the kind of friendships and everything that you have in Blaise Athletic and watching yourself and other players go on to achieve more? Or is it going to be the fact that you're probably the first Blaise Athletic player to have a parody account on Twitter?
No, I think, yeah, definitely my proudest moment would have to be sort of making a debut for Spurs and then obviously playing for England, and that'll stick with me forever. But I think sort of in not being non-league, it was, because Greg was sort of it was my first non-league club, but I was at Aldershot for a little bit, but I mean, after that, I was at Greg's for, that I count as a proper time I spent in non-league really. And we had, I don't know, we had such a good team, a good mix of people. I think that's, we done well, but not well enough. And that's why I'll probably look back on that first time. Even though sort of when I was at Bromley, we won the league at Bromley, Conference South, won it at Sutton. But I wouldn't count that as sort of my best time in my league, even though, yeah, the team that we had at Grace, I think we look back and think, it was decent, but yeah, it was good. I mean, it was a real good dressing room. We had a good buzz. So I think probably that I look back and think, yeah, probably should have done more or could have done more. Definitely.
Who's next?
Who's next? Oh no, you guys are not smart. Yeah. Hello.
Are you too famous?
No. No.
So that was unanimous. Anyone else? Phil Boston again.
This one for Jamie, to Jamie. The memories of Oxford Park. Can you give me one trophy, please?
What do I have? It was absolutely brilliant. That's like I said earlier. If you achieve something at a club, you have great memories there. Like Jamie said earlier, I've never had a squad with the team spirit had, I never experienced it. What was close was Wimbledon, but what we had at Grays was something special, and that's why those memories stick with me. But the day at Upton Park, I mean, it was fantastic. Listening to the crowd, listening to the cheers from all the fans, the atmosphere, it was brilliant. You know, walking out that tunnel, seeing all the blue skies, you know, after the game, I brought my little girl on the pitch, you know, I think she was a baby then. I've still got the pictures of that. It was just a fantastic day, the close-knit, the family, the club, the team spirit, the bonding, and it was so great to experience that with a great bunch of people.
Slabs.
It was a bit mixed for me really, because I was injured. So it was mixed for me, obviously. Delighted, I mean, what a day, it was a brilliant day. Great game, but yeah, I was gutted because I didn't play, but it was a great day.
This is a question for you, Slabs. Last season in the conference, basically we were struggling. You were there. We signed a striker called Fona Onyebuchi. Everyone knows him as Onyebuchi. But you and him in the first game, I think it was against Barrow, 3-3. And then after that, it seemed to Julie and Dix didn't want to know. But you just actually really scared one of the, I think they were about mid-table at the time. What are your thoughts about Julie and Dix? Because most great athletic fans think that he hasn't got a clue.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I didn't really get on with him, to be honest.
But you and Fowler, you scared the crap out of Barrow not being polite. As kids at it, so.
Yeah.
You know, I think you got two, he got another,
yeah.
We should have won. Next game, I think you were dropped.
I found him strange. You know, one minute he was alright, and then the next minute he'd go sort of right off you. I'm training and that. He was always. Training was good, to be fair, with Kenny Brown. He took most of it. He was good. Dix didn't really say much. He just wanted every tackle, he just wanted to smash someone.
Kenny seemed to be the guy that was.
Yeah, he was consistent, yeah.
But, you know, Julian, if any supporter said anything to Julian, he'd do the exact opposite.
Yeah, he was. That's hard for me to say. I didn't get on him. I didn't like him. I think the feeling was kind of mutual in the end. That's why I went, basically.
I think that says a lot. So, anyone else? Question three.
Out of the current squad, who's got the worst taste in music?
Wow, there's a few. And there's a couple sitting right over there.
You love it, bro.
No. Reject. No, to be fair, it's all right. Because I'm older, I haven't really heard of many of the songs, to be fair. But Addy's songs are weird. What he plays is weird.
You met him in your car over here,
right? Yeah, they're almost dancing. Filming each other dancing naked and stuff. It's not.
I think this might be going to be on the PG remit. Anyone else?
I was just going to comment after that West Ham game, the thing that really shocked us after that was Stimmer going. The very next day, and that was unbelievable. We'd been on such a high, okay, just to say with Halifax, you know, conceded a penalty at the end, didn't we? And we can remember that to this day, but Stimmer going, that really did shake us. Did it shake the team as well?
Definitely, it come right out of the blue. We we all got called in next day, didn't we? We was in the changing room. He sort of sat us all down and he said, "I'm off, I'm going." Offer from Stevenage and he said he'd like to take it on, but none of the boys could believe it. After, like I say, what we'd done, and it was a good season. Yeah, it was quite gutting to go to someone that will be in our league as well. I think that's what hurt us a bit more. Yeah, it was tough to swallow, wasn't it?
It was a tough time. There's a few of us Stimmo put on the side prior to that. So there's a couple of us that was aware, like me and Stuart Ferguson. It was awful after that, it was a shock. We felt hurt. We felt we had something good, and the camp had been pulled apart. And the likes of me, Stuart Thurgood, we wanted to try and keep the team together. And that was massive for us, because the team spirit, the togetherness was brilliant. We wanted to keep that going. We had managers come in, people come in, because of Grady's doing well, people jumped on the bandwagon, wanted to come in and take over, but we're understanding it. And we see people come in, and the players were hurting, disappointed, and we didn't want them. And there was obviously Justin had come in at the time. He was great. He wanted to keep that team spirit going, keep
what the boys were doing on that role. And then obviously he got asked to leave. And we was, the players were sick to death of it. We wanted stability, we wanted to keep achieving things. And we had people coming to the door, people going. And I think because the club meant so much to us, because what we've been through, the experience of the club, the team sort of, some of the players put their foot down, if you like. We took a stand, because it meant too much for us. We didn't want anyone coming in, doing things different, when everything was going so well, and we knew what made us click the gel. So it was a tough time, and I think that's probably one of the reasons why your likes of Stuart Fielding, Johnny Martin, Lee Matthews, all these players, Ashley Bayes, we still speak, we're still close, we're still great friends. And the likes of some of these boys that I've got back with me, that know what this means to me, know what it means to use. Slabber, you, Joe Bruce, these players, you know. And that's why they're here, Barry Coogan, they know what it means to me. And that's why they're here, a part of my team, because I want to bring the best to this club. And I won't have no other ball that don't want the same. And that's why you've got the squad that we've got.
Thank you, brilliant.
Yeah, thanks, Jamie. This one is a question from me again. But you obviously got appointed for one game. Was you disappointed in not being made permanent manager? Because Mickey then, after you'd done that one game in charge, appointed himself, which obviously proved great. And secondly, after you'd left the club, you were voted player for the decade. And what did you actually know of what was going on of that day when you were supposed to actually receive the award from Great Support Association for being player of the decade when you returned with Russian and Diamond? Because as far as we were aware, we were 20 minutes away from going bust.
What's the first question again? I'll answer the first one, second one after.
It was basically, were you disappointed after one game in charge where you made Concord United in the Cup not to be made permanently manager?
No, not at all. It was a good experience. I enjoyed it. I had a great bond with the players, and at that age, I was still taking a lot of training. I was taking defenders to the side, didn't work with them, you know. So, no, I wasn't ready for that group. I was still playing, and like I showed, I played for many years after left Grace, you know. So, no, it was a good experience. But, what's the next question?
The next one is, back in 2009, you were due to receive the award for player of the decade.
Yeah, I got a phone call a week before, I think 2 weeks before we was meant to play Grays, making me aware of the award, which was, I was honoured, and I was looking forward to going back to Grays, meeting you lot again and shaking hands, having a cuddle, having a chat, and it meant a lot to me, so I was excited. But then I got a phone call, I think 2 days before the game, saying that I'm not allowed to receive the award on the pitch because Andy Swallow wouldn't allow it. I didn't spoke to Andy Swallow on that day, and there was nothing to do with him. But yeah, I didn't know what was going on, you know. To me, I wasn't bothered about receiving the award. It was just, it meant a lot that I was notified, you know, that used people made that choice, and that meant more to me than anything, any award. So I was involved.
Okay, anyone else? Thank you again.
Going back to Ken. When you pointed out John Nutter's errors of his eyes. Do you still send him a Christmas card?
Thank you.
Okay.
I was just waiting for that one.
I'm a lot older than you now. This is no. I think I've always been the same. Not like that now, but I'm very passionate. I'm a winner. Anyone who knows me, anyone who's played me over the years, knows that I'm a winner. And I'd go for a brick wall for the football club. And if I'm playing in a team and I've got people around me putting out headers, shying out of the way, and we're getting punished for it because they're continuously attacking down a certain side, and I don't accept it. If that's my teammate playing alongside for me, wearing that shirt, I want him to put a shift in wearing that shirt. You know, he proved a great player, John. He was a good lad. And I think I ought to get to do it because of what I did. But no, okay, the story was, I had my left back now. He jumped out of a couple of tackles. I think someone was elbowing him, so he felt intimidated. And I said to him, be strong, don't accept it. And he kept accepting it. And as, I don't know if I was captain at the time or whoever it was, but as captain, vice captain, I don't want a player doing that in my team. So I let him know, next game, that don't happen again. So we had a little tuffle. I'll give him a little slap, basically. After that, he went on. He was brilliant. He went in tackles. He smashed people. And the rest of his game come out. And after that, he grew as a player. He was a fantastic player. I just felt let down. You know, you train hard all week. You prepare for that game. And if people ain't preparing the same as me, and I think I should do, then they're not just letting themselves down, they're letting the team down. I say to a lot of my boys, you don't have to like each other, you know. When you meet on that Saturday, you put all your differences aside, you're here to achieve something, and if you all stick together, you can achieve more. And when people ain't putting their weight, you have to let them know.
Anyone else? Good luck. Oh. Kind of related to you getting sent off against Camberley, the game before. We played on Boxing Day home to Camberley, and I think you were playing as well, those lads. It was the biggest crowd seen during the Stinson era. I think in real terms there was well over 4,000 people in the ground. Although the official attendance I think was 2,900. Not saying nothing. Bearing in mind that against West Ham there were spaces and we had 3,200. What was the atmosphere like among the team that day? Because you must have seen how many people were out there and come to see you play, because seeing attendance, which was literally packed into what was then the new rec, it must have been quite all, awesome, you know.
It was, I mean, I loved it. The rec, it had a buzz about it, it had an atmosphere, you got to the ground, it was enclosed. I mean, when I was younger, I used to go to the old den, Little Mall, with my uncles and them, it was great. And for some sort of reason, I don't know why, I had that same feeling of Grays, you know. It was packed, you had behind the goal, you had the ball courts, but the noise, and when you're playing as a player, it does make a massive difference, trust me, it does. You know, you go and put a tackle in, and you win a header, we can hear you cheering, clapping, it gives you a jig, it gives us a huge lot. Big voices. But it was great, it was fantastic, and that makes you want to stay in on the Friday night, get up Saturday early, prepare yourself, and put in a shift wearing that shirt, you know, because you could see what it meant to use lot. And that reflected on some of our performances and some of that commitment. I mean, back then, the players that wore that shirt, they would go for a brick wall for this club, and you could see that. And I think, because you could see that, you appreciate that, and that's why it went away with that team and then the memories.
Just echoing what Gaffer said,
were so close. The pitch and the stadium, everything was enclosed. You could definitely hear, you can hear everything. And it was probably too much sometimes. But yeah, it was, that's why I think the players reacted so well. And the kind of guys we had in the team, it was brilliant. It was brilliant for us.
Because you as a player, when you first come and start that season, you really started off like a house on fire. And then you probably suffered by the emergence of Aaron McLean more than anything. Because Aaron, you know, at the time you joined, probably couldn't hit a barn door. But, you know, the coaching you probably got from Stevenson, you know, eventually he was probably the best striker in the conference at that time. It's proved it by the fact that he's gone on to play in the Premier League. For you, it was probably quite frustrating.
What I remember at the time, it was sort of me and Dennis, or me and Aaron. And I know Aaron sometimes used to play wide right. And then I think it was when I got injured. And then Aaron went up front, and I think the rest is history. He couldn't stop scoring as soon as he sort of got his main chance, do you know what I mean? And was playing.
Yeah, because you were.
Yeah.
I think, you know, if you went up to the sort of end of November, you probably got about 8 or 9 goals at that point of time, and then Aaron come in. And,
I can't remember.
But, you know, you were like the guy that came in from Tottenham, and you were producing it. But then Aaron started banging the goals in.
He took over, and it was unbelievable. He went from strength to strength, literally. Yeah, he had everything. He did have everything. And he got much better playing up front regularly, definitely. And he, went on and on, didn't he?
Yeah. Okay, anyone else? Oh, well, Ben.
It's kind of a question that really goes across the field. Before I go on again about the glory years, I think really we all appreciate the fact that we spend a lot of time talking about the good old days, but a fair number of the current squad are here today is really appreciated because that's the current and that's the future. So that's unappreciated. But it goes across the preview really when I say that the aspiration, I guess, is the new ground. But I fear personally that time might be running out to kind of recognise what happened over 2, 3, 4 year span where so much happened and so many players put that shirt on and went on to do incredibly good things to Premier League. And my worry really is that can escape us, and really I suppose starting with Phil, whether or not you use that as inspiration for the kids, whether we talk about individuals that have gone on to put on our shirt and then go and put on some significant shirts in the footballing community, right up to the Premier League and European competition because they've played for Brazil in the past. And then for the James, I guess, whether or not we feel there's the opportunity, whether it be when we get a new ground or at some point to say, before this gets too late, are we going to get every single one of those players back? Some kind of for your benefit as much as ours, really, because, like you said, there's still part of your life, there's still people you speak to, probably not as much as you should. I just don't want that opportunity to pass any of us as supporters, and it's more important, really, for you guys. It's been a massive part of your life, and that needs to happen, isn't it? That kind of, we're all back together, days old, and Kylie and Cooper, with you guys as well, just to celebrate what everyone achieves in it. It can't happen.
Just quickly on that, you're right, and it's important, and I know that can happen. Like for the young players, Phil, you've got your Kai Browns, your Callums,
And I think Steve, Tony, Glenn, everyone behind the scenes does a fantastic job to keep these players here. And obviously, Addy's with us long term committed, so that's a great thing for the club. So if anyone does come in, then the club are going to be looked after, so that's massively important. And they're the groups who want to take eventually. What you said about the old boys, that era, them times, listen, if we can arrange something, I'm sure that can happen and I can make that happen.
The bit where you asked about whether we use the past glories to motivate the youngsters coming through, I think we're all old enough and wise enough to realise that we get to where we're going from looking at where we've been. But from the coaching perspective, to get players to get to the next level, you have to get them to motivate themselves. Not you as a coach motivate them, but the motivation has got to come internally. So you can't be there 24/7. So, as coaches, our job is just to light the flame in their heart, not the flame under their arse. Does that make sense? So once we've done that, away they go, and hopefully they're going to play for the first team and bring the future glories back to Greatham.
I actually think that's a very good time to finish. With a question like that, we've got the future, the present, and the past. But it's only the past because he's a Hall of Famer, because he decides the present. And over there, you've got a future Hall of Famer, Fisher. Thanks anyway, you're a future Hall of Famer.
Fish, you got off now to get a quick.
You know, we as a club, we look back on what we've achieved in the past, but we have to look what we can achieve in the future. And as a club, we are building those foundations now. So everyone get behind it, let's get these community shares and other donations going, and let's come on, let's get behind this club, let's keep going. We'll be back in great soon. Come on, everyone. Let's keep going, everyone. Come on.